What's going on, guys? By popular demand, you guys asked for it. You wanted to see how to measure squish clearance on your Yamaha Banshee, so I decided to make a little how-to video and show you exactly how I measure my squish clearance. Now, it doesn't matter if it's a Yamaha Banshee, this can be done on any two-stroke engine. It's the same process. All right, guys, so I'm putting together this 4mm 421 Banshee motor, and I figured this would be a perfect opportunity to go over measuring your squish and what your squish band is. So I have this Chariot cool head here with some driveline performance domes, and these domes make it really easy to show you where your squish band is. So this dome, when it's in our cylinder head, goes right over the pistons like so. So when your piston is at top dead center, right there, it's just about up against your squish band. So this cylinder head's going to be right here, and that's when you have your maximum amount of compression. Your piston is almost up against your cylinder head, your dome, but not quite touching. So this is the squish band right here. That's where the most amount of pressure is going to be in your dome. When your piston comes up, all the gases are being compressed, and this area gets squished into this center portion of the dome where your spark plug sits, and that's why it's called the squish band. So it's important that we measure the gap between the piston at top dead center and your squish band. So I'm going to show you how to do that, or at least the way that I do it. Now, just before I go putting our cylinder head on and showing you how to measure your squish band, I thought I'd make a little illustration here. I know my art is phenomenal, and I would kind of try to show you exactly what's going on in your cylinder and just what the squish band is. So basically what we have here is, imagine the side of your engine. So you could actually imagine this as a Banshee because we have two cylinders here, but what we have is our top dead center and our bottom dead center. So top dead center, which a lot of people refer to as TDC, is when your piston is all the way at the top, and bottom dead center is all the way at the bottom. So it's pretty self-explanatory with that. Now here are your cylinder walls. Here is your cylinder head. Our dome would be right here. This is our combustion chamber. It's where our fuel explodes and pushes our piston down. Got our spark plug with the electrode at the bottom, piston of course, and our rod. So what's going on here is at the bottom dead center, you have your gas and air mixture comes in your cylinder. And then on the way up, the fuel and air is going to be compressed, and as it goes up here, you have your squish band, which is, if you can see on our dome, this is that flat portion that I was pointing out. That's our squish band. So as this air and fuel comes up, that portion of fuel and air is going to be squished towards our spark plug. And what that does is it creates turbulence with our fuel, and it mixes the gas and air and causes a better explosion, creating more power, more fuel efficiency, like that. So once again, this area here is our squish band. And that up at the top here, all of the fuel and air is getting pushed into the combustion chamber to explode. Now, it's really critical to have this squish band be the right width, and you might be wondering why, because if you have a squish band that's too tight, that's when you get what's called detonation or pre-ignition. I'm sure you guys have heard of that before, or if you've ever blown up your dirt bike or your quad, and you have these little, like, almost like holes in the piston, looks like little divots, and I'm actually going to show you a picture right here of the top of my piston and my dome after I had a quad with detonation and it exploded. And what happens is the compression's too high and the fuel and air mixture actually explodes and starts to burn before the electrode of the spark even fires. And that causes heat to start forming here instead of here. So this is really where you want your explosion to start, with the spark of the spark plug. But when you have detonation up in the corners of your pistons because the compression's so high, then it can create hot spots. The edges of your piston get really hot, and that's when you get, like I said, detonation. And that causes those little pits and everything that you saw in that picture that I was just showing you of your dome. And then what can happen is those little pits, the edges can get really hot, and that's they're red hot. That can actually, that causes detonation and pre-ignition, because it's so hot that it causes the fuel and air mixture to actually explode before the spark plug goes off. So it's no good if you have your squish too small, and you also want to have it, you don't want to have it too big either, because if it's too big, you're not going to get optimal performance and fuel economy and stuff like that. The squish doesn't necessarily have to be the tightest that it can possibly go to get the best performance that there is. I'm not going to go over what squishes are optimal, because every motor is going to be different. It depends if you're running race fuel, pump gas. You got to take all that stuff into account. Now, if you did want to play around with your squish band, it's too big or it's too small. Typically, if it's too small, what you do is you change the thickness of your base gasket. You can put thicker gaskets in, thinner gaskets, to achieve the right amount of squish. And if your squish band is too big, you can shave down the deck of your cylinder, or do the same thing with your head. You can machine it down, shave it down to achieve a smaller squish band. Okay, guys, so let's get down to actually showing you how to measure a squish band. So we're here at the top end of this motor. This is a 421 Yamaha Banshee, and it does have a Chariot cool head on it. So don't be scared if your motor is different than this, if it doesn't have a cool head, if it doesn't have removable domes, if it's an entirely different motor, any two strokes is going to be the same process. Now, the process we're going to be using is the solder method. So I have some thick solder right here. This is 2.4 millimeters thick. It has to be thick solder, because if this is not as big as your squish band is, you're not going to get an accurate reading. So what we're going to do is clip off sections of solder. I already have my section cut right here. Figured I'd cut one of these for you guys just to show you exactly how it's done, because I know sometimes talking about it can be confusing if you haven't done it before. So we're going to make a section right here. It's probably about 4 inches long. And before I cut this, I want to point out, you see when this is cut, how it kind of leaves a point there? You want to cut both sides with a vertical cut. Keep them both the same. So that's cut, and you want to squish down on the cut like this, perpendicular. I think you get a more accurate reading that way. So what we're going to do is take about half the length of your cylinder and make a bend, and that'll measure one side, and you can see that line is vertical. Makes it easy that way. You can fit it right into your spark plug hole, and you know that's going to be vertical. And then I like to take the other side and bend it like a Z so that you can use this thing twice, and I'll show you why in a second. Okay, so now we're gonna take our piece of solder. Now I have it bent in a Z so that we can do one side, and then we'll flip it over and we'll get the other side. What we're gonna do is measure both the left and the right sides to make sure that we're getting an accurate reading and that they're equal. We're gonna do the left and right, not the top and bottom. Now we're just gonna take this piece of solder, fish it into our spark plug hole, and if you cut it correctly, you should be hitting up against your cylinder wall. Don't worry about scratching it or anything. The solder's soft. It's not going to do any damage at all. So what we're going to do is hold that solder up against our cylinder wall, and we're going to turn the motor over. Now, if you have your kicker on there, you can do it that way. If you have your flywheel on there, or your primary drive gear, whatever you're doing to turn over the motor, you want to go ahead and get that motor, the piston, the top dead center, so that it squishes the piece of solder. So I have a wrench here to turn the motor over, and what's going to happen, it's going to be nice and free. When it gets to the top, it's going to stop, and it's going to feel like it's not going to turn over. Don't worry about it. You can put some pressure on it, and then it'll kind of pop over, and I'll show you what I'm talking about, and that's when it's crushing the solder. Okay, so that's top dead center right there. You can see it's holding the solder in place. So I'm just going to push the motor over, and there it is. You see it just kind of popped over. And I'm going to run it over a couple more times just to make sure that that solder is nice and flat. There it goes. And you can see it's much easier once you've done it the first time, because the solder's been flattened out. There you go, nice and easy. So there's one side, nice and flat. Now we're going to go ahead and do the same thing on the other side of the piston. Once again, make sure you're touching up against that cylinder wall. There's top dead center. Alright, so there's both sides. So now that right there is our squish. That cylinder head and piston mashed this thing down nice and flat. What we're going to do is take a digital micrometer. Don't be sweating, guys. These things are really cheap. I picked this up at AutoZone for 13 bucks. Now this is a cheapie, so I mean, you could be much more accurate than this. But for what we're doing here and the purposes of this video, it's going to be perfect. So you can see, literally all you do is slide this thing and it tells you exactly what it is. It's in inches. You can also change it to millimeters, but we're going to keep it in inches for this video. And then what we do is spread this and we're going to pinch down and we're at 5/100ths of an inch. So for this motor, that's in spec. Now we'll check the other side and it should match up. 5/100ths. All right, so that's perfect. So then basically what I would do is go ahead and check the other cylinder, because this is a two cylinder. Make sure that they're all equal. If they're not, you got to play around with your gaskets, your base gasket, or you have to change the decking on your cylinders or your head, whatever it may be. But to check your squish, it's as easy as that. All right, so hopefully that was a clear enough explanation for what squish band is and how to check your squish clearance. I tried to do the best I could. I know sometimes going over, you know, the way motors work and checking clearances and stuff like that can be a little bit difficult to explain without actually seeing how things work, or like an animation, stuff like that. You know, I'm not that far advanced, but if you guys like this video, please remember to give me a thumbs up. If there's anything I could have done differently or something that would make it easier to understand, let me know in the comment section below, because I know a lot of you guys already know what squish clearance is and how to check it and everything. So if there's something you think I could do differently, let me know. Maybe I'll make another squish clearance video in the future that's better than this one. I love to improve on my videos and give you guys the best content that I can. So for you guys that are following Project 4Mil, I do have more content coming soon. I'm actually waiting on some parts for the clutch side. You can probably guess what it is, or at least what I'm hoping it's going to be. And I also have a set of genuine key-ins coming in. We're going to be doing a side-by-side comparison between the replica key-ins and the actual key-ins. And then we might even get this thing on the dyno and see the difference in power that this thing makes and whether or not it's, you know, worth the money to go for key-ins or if the replicas are just as good. All right, guys, remember to give me that thumbs up if you enjoyed this content. Also, remember to check me out on Instagram. It's MichaelSabo350. On there, you can send in pictures of your quad or dirt bike and any projects that you're working on that are quad and dirt bike related. So until the next one, guys, have a good week.